Hi, I'm Paul Barron, a final year PhD student at the University of Manchester, and I'm studying materials for nuclear fusion. It's Friday the 5th of March, and this is your Fission News Update. In the last few weeks, we've got a nice mix of stories covering the world of fusion. Let's take a look. 1. Roadmap to US fusion power plant comes into clearer focus. Sort of. 2. Fuel for world's largest fusion reactor, ITER, is set for test run. 3. Hydrogen fusion startup HB11 Energy hits $4.8 million in oversubscribed pre-seed raise. 4. Tokamak Energy and the Paul Scherrer Institute sign a collaboration and license agreement for high-temperature superconducting magnet technology. Plus a few bonus features at the end discussing the future of fusion energy. Our first story for today. Roadmap to US fusion power plant comes into clearer focus, sort of. The future of fusion power in the US is now slightly clearer, according to news published in Science magazine. The story follows the recent report by the National Academies of Science, Engineering and Medicine, which states that the US should aim to begin construction of a pilot fusion reactor by the year 2035, with a view to it being operational by 2040. According to the report, the US Department of Energy should aim to work in collaboration with private industry to develop workable concepts by 2028. This ambitious timeline has drawn mixed opinion from scientists. William Madia, Vice President Emeritus at Stanford University, says the plan is credible and doable, and that fusion will miss the train if it cannot show itself to be a viable part of the world's carbon-free energy supply. However, Edwin Lyman, Director of Nuclear Power Safety at the Union of Concerned Scientists, is more sceptical about the readiness of the relevant technologies, saying, "Reading between the lines, I didn't feel that it gives you a lot of confidence that these timetables are realistic." Not much detail is provided about what form the plant should take, but the report does state the pilot plant should generate around 50 megawatts of electrical power, only a fraction of what modern plants are capable of producing. It should also cost in the region of $5 to $6 billion, which would make it approximately one quarter the price of ITER. Which brings us nicely to our next story. 2. Fuel for world's largest fusion reactor, ITER, is set for test run. Researchers at the Joint European Torus, or JET, are preparing the reactor for experiments with deuterium and tritium fuel, according to the report from Nature. The scientists, based at the Cullum Centre for Fusion Energy in Oxfordshire, are testing this fuel mixture for the first time since 1997 in preparation for using the same fuel in ITER. It also means that once again, JET will be making real fusion reactions and generating fusion power. JET holds the current world record for fusion power produced at a value of 16 megawatts, which is equivalent to 67% of the reactor's input energy. Deuterium and tritium are both isotopes of a hydrogen, and the deuterium-tritium fusion reaction is the easiest to achieve, so they are the most accessible way of fueling a fusion reactor. However, tritium presents additional difficulties due to the fact that it is both radioactive and not found in nature. Despite these difficulties, the JET team are not fazed. Joël Malou, who co-leads the scientific programme at JET, says, "It's very exciting to get to the point where we can put into practice what we've been preparing all these years. We're ready for it." And Ian Chapman, CEO, added, "We've had to refresh and renew all of our processes, from storage to handling. Once tritium experiments start, neutron bombardment will make the inner facility radioactive, so it will become a no-go zone for humans for 18 months. You can't just go in and fix things, it has to work first time." It is hoped these experiments will aid the understanding of how plasma will behave in ITER and other future fusion devices. Story 3. Hydrogen fusion startup HB11 Energy hits $4.8 million in oversubscribed pre-seed raise. The Sydney-based company has exceeded their funding expectations, according to a story in Business News Australia. HB11 Energy originally set out to raise $1 million Australian through pre-seed fundraising. However, the company ended up raising almost five times that amount. Co-founder and managing director Warren McKenzie had this to say, "I've never imagined we'd make almost $5 million in a pre-seed round during a pandemic. We originally set out to raise $1 million to kick off as a startup company, but with the significant investor interest, we extended the round so we could launch straight into experiments well ahead of schedule. 2021 will be all about building an international team of researchers and collaborators across areas of laser engineering, plasma physics, nuclear physics, and material science." HB11's reactor will utilise lasers fired at a hydrogen and boron-11 fuel mix from which the company gets its name. If successful, this novel method of creating fusion would generate no radioactivity in structural materials, as is the case with conventional deuterium-tritium fusion. The early investors will no doubt be keeping an eye on the company's preliminary results, some of which are currently under peer review. Number 4. Tokamak Energy and Paul Scherrer Institute signed a collaboration and license agreement for high-temperature superconducting magnet technology. Our final story today is about a new collaboration between private fusion company Tokamak Energy and the Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland. Tokamak Energy has entered into a license agreement with the Swiss Research Institute for the use of Tokamak Energy's high-temperature superconducting magnets for particle accelerator applications. The magnets, made from a composite material known as rare earth barium copper oxide, or REBCO, have been developed by Tokamak Energy for use in the magnetic coils of fusion devices. The magnets are attractive options for use in fusion because they produce higher magnetic fields than conventional superconductors, and the ones developed by Tokamak Energy are both robust and reliable. These features are also attractive for particle accelerator experiments. This partnership is a clear example of how fusion companies can utilise their technology successfully in non-fusion industries. Jonathan Carling, CEO of Tokamak Energy, said, "We are excited by the opportunity of working collaboratively with one of the world's leading research establishments in PSI and seeing our unique magnet technology utilised in new applications. This is a further endorsement of our world-leading magnet technology." Bernard Ochman, project leader at the Paul Scherrer Institute, added, "The non-insulated coil technology of Tokamak Energy is innovative and incredibly robust. We want to show that it is the right choice for future upgrades of the Swiss light source. Collaborating with Tokamak Energy and licensing their technology will accelerate our R&D by years and help to lend credibility to our ambitious goals." And now, here are some bonus articles. Bonus number one. Scientists use supercomputers to study reliable reactor design and operation. A story in phys.org has detailed how some of the world's most powerful supercomputers may be able to help in the quest for viable fusion energy. Bonus 2. Carbon capture, hydrogen, fission or fusion. Which can take us to net zero by 2050? A discursive piece published in Forbes magazine summarises the pros and cons and some of the technologies that will help reduce global carbon emissions. Fusion is featured alongside carbon capture, nuclear fission and hydrogen. Give it a read, we'd be curious to hear your thoughts. And finally, bonus article number 3. Nuclear fusion, building a star on Earth is hard, which is why we need better materials. To wrap things up, we have an article from one of my colleagues here at Manchester, Dr. Anika Khan. In this piece for The Conversation, Anika details why developing new materials should be a core component of fusion research. As usual, all links are in the description below. If you'd like to see more fusion news, be sure to like and subscribe for another update in 2 weeks' time. That's all for this week. Thanks for listening.